Thank you, of course, from me and Esty to Laura and Lewis for once again offering their beautiful home for such a special evening like this. Thank you not only for your hospitality tonight, but also for your persistent commitment to the arts, which we all who have known you for so many years appreciate. This evening I have the honor of conversing with Esther Knobel, one of the most eminent Israeli jewelers, past winner of the Françoise Van den Bosch Prize in the Netherlands, and also of the Andy Prize in Israel. Esty, your practice has been referred to as, and everybody who speaks Hebrew, please forgive me, Melechet Machshevet.
You're doing better.
Okay, good. Believe me, we rehearse Sunday morning. I have practiced this. That and the bracha over the wine is about all I know. What does that mean in English, seriously?
Well,
at Machshevet.
I should say it actually started with the English. About 10 years ago, when I was beginning to work on my artist book or
right.
on the process, I came across the term in English, the mind in the hand. I found it in, unfortunately, I couldn't refine the book at home, so I can't remember. It was a book about collecting, and I was extremely touched by this simple phrasing mm-hmm. of the mind in the hand. It suddenly kind of seemed to make sense of what I feel I'm doing and not being able to verbalize. And I called my friend Ora, mm-hmm. Ora Itan. She's a children's book illustrator, and she's a very good, she is very knowledgeable of language. And I said to her, isn't it an amazing phrase? And she said, you know what it is. It is Melechet Machshevet. Melechet Machshevet, when
you...
Melacha is craft, handwork. Machshava is thought. And it is a biblical phrase. Mm-hmm. And as far as I know, my knowledge in the Bible, Stephen, sorry, is limited. But for me, it is completely connected with building of the portable temple. That's how I remember it. I looked it up in Wikipedia recently and I realized it's not quite that. I mean, it's not right to put it this way, but it is a very anachronistic term of describing craft. I was very kind of taken by the comeback
mm-hmm.
of a very old-fashioned phrase that describes craft. So that's
and
how I...
Those pieces there really are just sort of just wallpaper, a little mini survey of some of Esty's older pieces. You know, your work is so multivalent and deeply layered. It's deceptively simple. And I think the clearest approach to making your work understood this evening is to separate the threads for discussion and then kind of knit them together, much like your knitted and enameled copper wire series, which we will see in a bit. So I think we'll start with found objects. This piece, which is an early piece from 1977 that I believe you did in London, I know is very special to you. And you expressed to me how the idea behind it keeps resurfacing in your work throughout.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to comment about the pine needles necklace?
Yeah, I consider it to be my first real piece of jewelry, although I've made quite a few pieces before that. I trained at Bezalel and then I went to the Royal College. And that was one of my graduation pieces there. It really is a copy of a piece we used to make, well, a piece of jewelry we used to make as children under the pine trees.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the pine needles, they have like two needles in one pocket.
Right.
So we would pull one needle. I'm explaining because I know not everywhere children have the same tradition, but I know in the Middle East countries, mm-hmm. This is recognizable. So we used to like pull one needle and then push the end of the other, the one that is left, into the pocket to make a loop and then make a chain.
I actually went on Wikipedia today to see what pine needles looked like. I thought I knew.
You know, the challenge was to try and make, to recreate this childhood memory of of my precious first necklace. And then I could kind of use different facilities of coloring metal. That was what I was interested in at the time. So,
you know, in studying Esty's work for this presentation, she is very object-oriented, am I right in saying mm-hmm. that? Whether the objects are actually appropriated and used in their either entirety or in part in a piece, or whether they have in fact just inspired a direction.
Mm-hmm.
I think one of the overriding characteristics is that they are so object-oriented. The ready-mades are again either a source of inspiration or also appropriated into the work. Can you tell us what attracts you to what's, and I'm gonna, I added something after we spoke, lost, abandoned, or simply borrowed? And, you know, what is it
well,
that attracts
you? Well, I need an object to make an object. Mm-hmm. I mean, I can't, if I don't have something to start from, something visual, I can't work, so
the piece that I wanted to draw attention to is the gold piece that is kind of a third of the way over, that gold-colored mm-hmm. piece, which that's an infantry emblem that was run through a dye press, and that reminded you of the Cedars of Lebanon.
Mm-hmm.
And then next to it, and like diagonally opposite, there are three total found objects, which are copper talisman
containers.
No,
they are not all. The middle one is some one I made.
Right. Okay. Why don't you talk about those?
When I received the Andy Prize for the exhibition, I decided to edit my work in a way that to blur between the actual pieces that I made and the found object. So I was just kind of pulling stuff from my drawers, and it all consisted of things I bought, things I found on the ground, things I never finished, and this kind of blur is a place that I like to be in. Is actually about not distinguishing between found things, artwork that is a part of the process, mm-hmm. and finished pieces. I mean, it was also the exhibition was constructed this way, but I mean, we could talk about it mm-hmm. for days. I mean, why anyone is choosing to recycle and not start off from the blank page.
And this necklace is made from recycled parts of recycled drinking cans, right? To resemble
yeah.
bottle
but,
caps?
But the caps, the bottle caps are completely handmade. I just to say one or two words about this attitude of holding on to found objects or it's very much related to my upbringing. I mm-hmm. mean, when I became committed to making jewelry, mm-hmm. it was the time jewelry was being questioned and redefined, and was like the late 70s, beginning of the 80s, we were looking for new materials mm-hmm. to define preciousness, to question preciousness, and being me, I went, you know, to the very extreme, and I've been always doing that ever since. Mm-hmm. I mean, my work was always in non-precious materials. And probably personality thing. Some people, you know, can just imagine, visualize. Mm-hmm. I don't visualize. I have to see something to get
that's
going.
That's probably why you're so object, you know, maybe object oriented.
Because I start from an object.
You start from an object. Mm-hmm. You know, although your output isn't really thematic, there are certainly certain emotional, societal, and technical categories, mm-hmm. Often interrelated, mm-hmm. actually always probably interrelated, that consistently reappear. And you possess an admirable ability to combine humor and pathos, playfulness and fortitude, resignation and hope. And with that in mind, let's look at some of the I think most potent pieces. So family, I think, is one theme that you certainly deal with. And could you talk about those hand pieces?
Yeah, I kind of draw from life because I kind of see jewelry as my language. An artistic way of expressing myself, or way of expressing myself without artistic. So these are pieces from the late 80s, I think, and they're not jewelry pieces, they're kind of rings or hand pieces. They are inspired by photographs, looking at photographs, so you have a photograph in your hand. And the left one is a depiction of a picture of my son, Jonathan, when he was a baby.
And it's called Prince,
the
right?
Prince, yeah. Mm-hmm. And the right one, of course, is the mother. And they are they take from tin toys. Mm-hmm. They have movement in them. They kind of redefine what a ring would be. Like normally you would wear a ring on the front of your hand. This is a ring
for the inside. Actually, I think I read somewhere you were saying how you carry this through life. You know, you the hand piece, you carry the piece with you, mm-hmm. as you would carry your family. This one is particularly fascinating because this shows the photo that inspired the brooch.
Mm-hmm. I like this photo so much. I made a piece of it's something between a toy and a brooch, made in nickel silver, mm-hmm. and it's called Rabbit in Pram. It has movement. It has a pin at the back.
Yeah, it is a brooch. A sort of a brooch toy, and a completely different technique. My grandmother is knitting too. The process. Now, I hope you can all see. These pieces are actually knit. And describe the process by which you knit this, because it's fascinating. It's copper wire.
Maybe it is, interesting to mention that my mother died at around that time. When she was ill, I was with her in the hospital, and I needed to do something. Mm-hmm. So I brought some of this. It's telephone wire that I would pick up from the street. I mean, in Israel, where they have these street telephone boxes, and they, when they have excess wire and they have nothing to do with it, you know, we don't do very well with putting our rubbish away, so they would just drop it next to the box and I would collect it. And I knitted it. It has copper wire inside it. And so, you know, I would knit this plastic coated copper wire into images. I'm not a big knitter, but it was like practicing knitting. And then I burnt the plastic out and enameled it. So,
right. So the plastic was burned. You know, we've all seen telephone wire. The plastic was burned off after Esty knit the forms, and then the color was derived from enameling.
It's not only the color, it's also knitting should be soft, but mm-hmm. an enamel is kind of...
Enamel's hard.
hard and brittle. So it was like looking very soft, but kind of surprisingly not nice to hold. It's also brittle. It's kind of, it sort of is slightly falling apart with time. And the installation is also a sort of bringing back a childhood memory. It's a little kit of a girl with a teddy bear and a brooch and my pliers, which I knitted handles for, and some little brooches and a thimble. So just a silly little kit.
I think that the series is just a wonderful example of, you know, Esty's commitment to family and then this invention of new techniques to depict these very potent subjects, but also humorous, light subjects, and to integrate them all, which is, I think, really one of the brilliances.
This ambivalence is very strong in my work. I mean, I kind of touch a traumatic and sad subjects, but then very often I kind of try to be playful about it, not to get too heavy. So it's always this kind of gentle balance mm-hmm. between.
And I think as we look at all of her series, we're going to see this coming up in different manifestations. Nature is another one of Esty's big influences. Flora Palestina, which was a large series. I'm actually wearing a brooch that you gave me. Thank you.
Good for me.
From this series. Tell us, what does Flora Palestina mean?
Well, Flora Palestina means what it sounds. Flora is the flowers and Palestina is Palestine. Oh, mm-hmm. So it's the flowers of Palestine. When Israel was formed, I mean, some professional people like the botanists were trying to define Israel through its flora, its flowers. In my very young days, when I was a young student at the Bezalel, I was working for Professor Zohari, who is expert was, I mean, he's dead by now, but he was the expert on the flora of Israel. He wrote all the flowers dictionary, so I had a special bond. I was drawing and copying images for his books. And I myself studied biology in high school. I thought I will become a biologist, actually. I loved flowers, I still do. So all these kind of facts were combined and, you know, deserves being set in a piece of jewelry.
And those are all rings, which is pretty amazing.
I call them more studies for rings. Mm-hmm. They're quite flat. They're something in between drawings and objects. It's interesting to mention, I mean, we are not talking about politics today, but Flora Palestina, flowers of Palestine were represented on postcards and Israeli souvenirs in the early days, in the 50s. I mean, not anymore, but if you walk around antique shops, you can still find cards that have leaves and fabricated kind of different flower shapes stuck onto them. So that was another inspiration, just antique old objects and the whole notion of Israel and Palestine.
And these baskets now, it's the same basket, right?
This is the same, the structure is the same. Mm-hmm. And the difference is in the decoration. So, I mean, you have to believe me, but you can probably, if you look well, you can see it. It's the same basket. We only just changed the decoration from dried roses to hot peppers. You can do anything with it. I mean, it's kind of an approach to involve the owner in doing the decoration, and it relates to a tradition that we have in Israel in the harvest ceremony, that's mm-hmm. in the late spring. We, as children, used to take baskets with vegetables and fruits and good things to the school as offerings.
Right.
And you know, in the 50s we had nothing, so we would recycle my mother would take an old shoebox and make it into a basket, just
right.
and
wow.
decorate it. So that is the memory.
Remembrance also and grief are themes that you have embraced. Tell us about the train, because this is a necklace which I think has many, many layers of meaning. Mm. It looks like a toy train, but I think it's far more than that. And by the way, it is in the permanent collection of the Stedelijk Museum in Amsterdam.
Yeah, this is a kind of outstanding piece. I normally make my work in series, so mm-hmm. there is more than one. There is nothing like this. I've never made anything like it before or after. You can relate it a little bit to the snake series.
Snake, that's in Montreal.
It's chronologically and also technically very related, but it came before the snakes, mm-hmm. so... It's a kind of Wagnerian piece, very kind of heavy, and when I made it, you know, and thinking about this train going around your neck, I mean, it is
like
a Holocaust piece.
It looks like that's the dichotomy that you know I'm trying to illustrate in Esty's work. I mean, it looks like a toy, but it certainly has references to the Holocaust. Also, it's a choker, and it's real. I mean, it looks like it could really choke you. It doesn't seem to have any beginning or end.
Yeah.
So it's this, you know, this juxtaposition of of seriousness and levity.
Mm-hmm. It's weird psychology. I am not qualified to talk about it, but... I mean, this kind of very colorful period, and then this came, so.
So these, the Requiem pieces, these are from 1994, this is later. So this is a series of pendant objects. Yeah, they're box pendants or object pendants. Just replete with meaning. Can you address these for
Yeah, it's kind of, you know, sad to see these pieces follow each other. Yeah, later on, Sandy is wearing the later version with
on
the enamel.
Metal. Yes.
And that is really a take on Monk.
Mm-hmm. What does the string represent that's covering the eyes of the...
That came later. Actually, I mean, what I did in these pieces was imitate or copy the structure of a matchbox.
Right.
I just so it's like a little drawer that you can store things in it, and
matchboxes also can burn when you light.
Probably, yeah. And the string, I meant to hang them, but because I wanted them to be a group. I mean, I called them Requiem, and I. Imagine them singing a requiem. It was handy to wrap the thread around the box just to keep it, tidy. And then I thought they actually are kind of masks for the eyes.
Right.
So the pieces sometimes grow, evolve mm-hmm. in the making. So and ideas become kind of more. More evident as I go along.
Well, this one, the matchboxes with the little knit hats.
Mm-hmm. That was trying to give them some kind of healing. You know, they were
right.
so troubled.
The healing is also something that I found to run through Esty's work.